So that will be the first video. So now this will be the second part of this video under module 5 digital security. Okay, so stay tuned until the end of the video.
Okay, this is the second part of our module 5 under digital security, ethics and privacy, threats, issues and defenses. So my kind reminder, to use your earphones for better audio. Okay, so we only have one objective for our video today, where I will discuss the techniques to prevent any unauthorized computer access and use. Okay, now let's start with the first slide. Now, unauthorized access is the use of a computer or network without permission. Unauthorized use is the use of a computer or its data for unapproved or possibly illegal activities. Unauthorized use includes a variety of activities such as an employee using an organization computer to send personal email messages, or maybe an employee using the organization's word processing software to track his or her the child's software risk score, or a perpetrator gaining access to a bank computer and performing an unauthorized transfer. Organizations take several measures to help prevent unauthorized access and use. At a minimum, they should have a written acceptable use policy, or AUP, that outlines the activities for which the computer and network may and may not be used. To protect your personal computer from unauthorized intrusions, you should disable file and printer sharing in your operating system. This security measure attempts to ensure that others cannot access your files or your printer. So the following section will address other techniques for protecting against unauthorized access and use. First, access control. Many organizations use access controls to minimize the chance that a perpetrator intentionally may access or an employee accidentally may access confidential information on a computer, mobile device or network. An access control is a security measure that defines who can access a computer device or network, when they can access it, and what actions they can take while accessing it. The computer device or network should maintain an audit trail that records in a file both successful and unsuccessful access attempts. An unsuccessful access attempt could result from a user mistyping his or her password, or it could result from a perpetrator trying thousands of passwords. Now let's discuss on the username and password. A username, also called a user ID, login name or signing name. It is a unique combination of characters such as letters, four of the alphabet or numbers that identifies one specific user. Password is a private combination of characters associated with the username that allows access to certain computer resources. So this figure 5.6 shows how a bank require a user to enter a username and password. Then, passphrase. A passphrase is a private combination of words often containing mixed capitalization and punctuation associated with a username that allows access to certain computer resources. Passphrase often can be up to 100 characters in length, are more secure than password, yet can be easy to remember because it can contain words. PIN. A PIN or personal identification number, sometimes called passcode. It is a numeric password either assigned by a company or selected by a user. Then, possess object. A possess object is any item that you must possess or carry with you in order to gain access to a computer or computer facility. For example, the card you use in an ATM machine. It's a possess object that allows access to your bank account. Next is biometric device. A biometric device authenticates a person's identity by translating a personal characteristic such as a fingerprint into a digital code that is compared with a digital code stored in a computer or mobile device, verifying a physical or behavioral characteristics. The example of biometric devices and systems include fingerprint readers, face recognition system, hand geometric system, a voice verification system, signature verification system, iris recognition system, and retinal scanner. First, we have fingerprint reader. A fingerprint reader or fingerprint scanner captures curves and indentations of a fingerprint, as you can see in figure 5.8. Then we have face recognition system. This system captures a live office image and contrasts it with a stored image to determine if the person is a legitimate user. A hand geometry system will whereby measure the shape and size of a person's hand, as you can see in figure 5.10. A voice verification system is a system that compares a person's live speech with their stored voice pattern. A signature verification system recognizes the shape of your handwritten signature as well as measures the pressure exerted and the motion used to write the signature. An iris recognition system is a high security iris. The camera in an iris recognition system uses iris recognition technology to read patterns in the iris of the eye, as you can see in figure 5.11. Next is two-step verification. Two-step verification, also known as two-factor verification, where a computer or mobile device uses two separate methods, one after the next, to verify the identity of a user. ATMs usually require a two-step verification. Users first insert their ATM card into the ATM, where this will be step 1, and then enter a PIN, which is the step 2, to access their bank account. Most debit cards and some credit cards also use PIN. Another use of two-step verification requires a mobile device and computer. When users sign in to an account on the computer, they enter a username and password, which is step 1. Next, they are prompted to enter another authentication code, which is step 2, which is sent as a text or voice message or via an app on a mobile device. You can see in figure 5.12. Then we have digital forensics. Digital forensic, also called cyber forensic, is the discovery, collection, and analysis of evidence found on computers and networks. Many areas use digital forensic, including law enforcement, criminal prosecutors, military intelligence, insurance agencies, and information security departments in the private sector. So that's all for the second part of module 5. I will continue in the next part of this module next video. Thank you. Bye.